You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon to our young scholars throughout the state of California. This is Philosophy 120, Critical Reasoning with Robert Cubijos, coming to you from the California State University, Dominguez Hills. Look forward to today's broadcast and want to give you some opportunities again to call in and give us some responses to questions of the day. We'll have a couple of those for you. Let me remind you that calling in to 800-339-1193 or emailing us at the email address you see at the bottom of your screen will result in a participation point. So those of you that are watching us live, we encourage you to call in or email in a response. Those of you that are watching us on YouTube, you can also email in your responses to those critical reasoning questions of the day anytime. And if you are successful in responding, you will get the point. We have been in chapter 2 since the last part of our broadcast. We're continuing in chapter 2, and we've been talking about definitional techniques. Definitional techniques. We will continue that, but a few more pieces of housekeeping. You need to look on Blackboard, and in anticipation and preparation for next week's broadcast, there's a couple of things you ought to print out. One is the project, critical reasoning project number one, called Whom Will You Hire? Have that ready. Print it out and have it ready since we'll be talking about it. That is located on Blackboard on the left-hand band of tabs under, critical reasoning projects, CR projects. There's also a sample project in there that has to do with biomedical decision making. Again, in preparation for next week's broadcast, also print out that. There is a decision-making grid that is at the back of that that is important for our decision-making. Matter of fact, if you go with me to the overhead cam, let me show you a printout of what those two pieces look like so you know exactly what you're looking for. If we're able to do that, the first is the critical reasoning response number one on the overhead camera. Are we able to do that? Probably need to prepare that. There we are. This is called Decision Making in Business, Whom Will You Hire? And you need to read through this in preparation for our broadcast next week. It's all of 2 pages. Most important is the decision making table. I will teach you how to use this decision making grid. It's also called a decision making table or a tableau. And you will use this for your first critical reasoning response. I will guide you through a biomedical decision making that has a slightly larger decision making grid. We've got A, B, C, D, E, F, G, 7 variables, and we've got 8 criteria. Once you know how to use this decision making table, you can apply this to any variety of decisions that you will face. So have both of these printed out and ready to go for next week's broadcast. Let's also talk a little bit about the completion of chapter 2. Just like the completion of chapter 1, we will have the homework for points link up and running as soon as we finish chapter 2. We may get close to doing that today. And if so, you will see either later tonight or tomorrow the link for the homework for points put up. You'll also see a link for the quiz number 2 to be up and running. Not to worry, you will receive an announcement and an email, as you always do, when those items are posted. We just want to alert you and remind you that at the end of each chapter, there is typically the homework for points that is due and a quiz. After we finish chapter 1 and chapter 2, we're going to skip over chapter 3. At the end of the semester, we'll swing back around and get into chapter 3, but we're going to skip up to chapter 4. We might even have a chance to start some of chapter 4 today, depending on how we go. But for those of you that are reading ahead, you need to know that we're going to skip chapter 3 and jump into chapter 4. So be ready for that so it doesn't come as any kind of a surprise. And chapter 4 is slightly more complex. Therefore, we will slow down and take very careful note of a number of the terms and the concepts and the methods that are associated with categorical propositions and categorical syllogisms, the very building blocks of logic. So, getting now into our lecture, last week we covered the first three types of definitional techniques. That was the stipulative definition, the lexical definition, and also the precising definition. Now we want to jump into our question of the day, and then we will get into some of the other types of definitional techniques, a theoretical definition and so on. But the question of the day has to do with made-up words. Can you give us an example of an unusual or a made-up word that's used in your family and give us its definition? For example, I would arrive at home after spending most of the day at the university, and my younger brothers would come in after a while, after I'd been home for a little while, and I would usually yell at them as they're coming in the front door from way back in the den, "Jeet," J-E-E-T, Jeet. I would just blurt that out. Well, that's an elision, a combining of all of the words, "Have you eaten yet?" Or, "Did you eat?" "Jeet." "Have you eaten anything yet?" So that's one family example of a made-up word, J-E-E-T, Jeet, which means, "Have you eaten anything yet?" So call into the studio or email in an example of a family word or a made-up word or an unusual word and also give us the definition. The contact points have just been put at the bottom third of your screen. Call in or email in, and we will then go on ahead and give you a participation point if you respond correctly. Well, let's go on ahead and do some of the sample problems that relate to the first three types of definitional statements that we talked about. And these sample problems have to do with these. Well, let me just go ahead and jump in. First is the word scale. See if you can identify in the confines of your own mind the proper response to this question. Scale means, one, either a device for weighing, or two, fish skin, or three, a series of musical notes. Well, what type of a classification of definition is this in your mind? We'll give you just a moment to respond, and hopefully you responded correctly with the first option, which is a lexical definition. This is distinguishing one or more meanings as you would find in a dictionary. And dictionaries used to be called lexicon. This is a lexical definition. Take a look at this next problem. A senior, in quotation marks, that's the word, the definiendum, what we're defining, means when buying a ticket that a purchaser must be at least 65 years old. You notice the context there? When buying a ticket, well, that's digging in, and that's getting very close to the context that they're trying to tell you, in which they mean a senior. And if you chose precising definition, you would be right. The meaning of the word senior is a little imprecise. This nails down the context in which they're using that word. This is a precising definition that we just read. Let's see if you can get this next one. A tub top. A tub top means a computer you can use in the bathtub. What kind of a definition would you classify this as? Do you think it's lexical? Do you think it's precising? Or do you think it's a stipulative definition where you're stipulating the definition for the first time? That's right. If you chose the last one, stipulative definition, where the meaning is being assigned to it for the first time, you would get the point on the quiz if there was a question like that. And there are questions like that, so hopefully you're following along very closely. Well, we have some other definitional styles or definitional techniques that you need to be aware of. Why don't we jump into some of those? The next one is a theoretical definition. And sometimes some concepts are so theoretical or so intense that it requires maybe some scientific type of understanding or chemical or biological type of understanding. So a theoretical definition gives a theoretical characterization to the entities that the term denotes. For example, gold, which is the definiendum, the word that we're defining, means an element having an atomic number of 79 and an atomic weight of 197. What I read or said after the definiendum is the definiens, the word doing the defining. So this definition identifies gold by its elements, in terms of its atomic theory of the elements. That's a theoretical definition. Let's push on to a persuasive type of definition. A persuasive type of definition not only conveys meaning, but it also has an emotive element in that it tries to engender either a favorable response towards the definiendum, the word we're defining, or it tries to engender an unfavorable response or reaction to the word that we're trying to define. For example, the word communist. Here's a possible definition. Communism or communist means a person who values every human individual and who accords universal equality and basic rights to every human being. As you can probably discern, this is giving you a favorable definition. It's trying to engender your favor towards communism. So this is a persuasive definition, one that's trying to engender a favorable response towards the term of communist. So be aware that there are different types of definitional techniques, different types of definitions. Let's try a few more sample problems, see how you do. The word earth is what we're defining, and here's the words we're going to use to define it. Earth means a still oblate spheroid at the center of our solar system. How would you classify that definition? Well, probably not out of the dictionary. I don't see a series of numbers that give me different definitions. Theoretical definition, persuasive. If you said theoretical, you would get the point. That is correct. That is a theoretical definition of the word Earth. Take a look at this next one for the word cyber date. Let's define this word cyber date. It means a date arranged over the internet. How would you classify that definition? You think it's lexical? Maybe it's stipulative or precising? Well, cyber date's a rather new word. It wasn't around maybe 10, 15 or more years ago. So that's a new word. We're assigning a definition to it for the first time, adding a couple of words together, cyber and date. That's the stipulative definition. That is correct. Take a look at this next example, sample problem, and see how you do on it. The word drunk we're going to define, it's in quotation marks, means, comma, when driving a vehicle in California, close comma, having a blood alcohol ratio of greater than or equal to 0.08%. Do you think that's a lexical definition? Maybe a persuasive definition? If you said that it's a precising definition, you would be spot on the mark. Drunk is vague, so this definition points it down by telling you in what context. And usually it's the commas that offset the context. When driving a vehicle in California, that's telling you precisely the context in which we are speaking. Well, we want to go to a video before we go much further, talking about lexical definitions and techniques and all. And as they're getting ready to do the video in the control room there, I see that we've got Michelle Anselmo. Michelle, how are you doing today? Thanks for calling in or for emailing in. You were saying and telling me here that an unusual word that my mom uses that used to tell us to go to bed is tuto tuto. I don't know why, but it means go to bed in made up words. That's exactly what I'm talking about. And tuto tuto is a great example of a made-up word, and the stipulative definition of tuto tuto means go to bed, right? From what we just learned about stipulative type definitions. It used to be that I had a cousin by the name of Tutho. His actual name is Ivan. And I need to ask him where his made-up baby name Tutho came from. Now, usually in the French culture, the first words that a baby utters is the word that they attach as the baby name for that child for the duration of its life. So in France, kids uttering their first words need to be very careful what they say because that's going to be attached to them for life. Noah Lay is calling in or responding in, and he's giving a word called preparated. Preparated, I've never heard that before. The definition to be prepared, preparated, like I was preparated for the test. Noah, thanks for that. Michelle and Noah, both of you are getting a participation point, and thanks for that. The rest of you, if you have a family word or you know of a made-up word or an unusual word, call in, give us the example, and give us the definition so you can get the participation point today. Thank you to Michelle and to Noah. Well, in the video that we're going to be calling up here, it demonstrates how the definiendum, the word that's being defined, sounds very strange, and how the definiends, the words doing the defining, should give us a cognitive understanding of the word. And so in this video, we're going to watch 12 nouns with absurdly specific definitions. Take a look at this.
Call tag. Ageless. Hippopotomonstrosesquipedaleophobia. Tarantism. Mesodactylitis. Quiddler. Barn.
We got cheap wood for you.
Xylopolist.
Cheap wood. Cheap wood.
Pre-anti-penultimate. Ultra crepidarianism.
Carbon matter inside a person.
Aglet. Croissant.
Interesting. So the definiendum, the word that we are defining, has in this video some very specific, absurdly specific definiends, the words doing the defining. They really went the extra mile to try and nail it right on the head and did a pretty good job. Folks, before we jump into section 2.5 of chapter 2, skipping over chapter 2.4, we'll circle back around on that. I had assigned some homework problems over the last video, and as we got to the end of each section, I had given you some homework assignments. The answers are on Blackboard under homework assignments. The tab at the left that says homework. And if you dig around in there, you can find the answers. Only go to those afterwards. But sometimes you may not know how to arrive at those answers. So I want to take a couple of moments to just do a few of the problems that were assigned for homework and do also some additional problems that were not assigned but are similar to the ones that were assigned. So you get a feel for how to do the homework problem. So on the overhead camera, we've got a couple of worksheets that identify the problems that were assigned. The first set were in exercises 2.2 there at the end of section 2.2. Under Roman numeral 1, there were problems 1 through 4. That was on pages 92 to 93. The instructions read for problem number 2, to name some of the attributes that are connoted by the following terms. Connotation means that you're talking about the word's attributes. Express your answers with adjectives or adjectival phrases. So you would say that a drum connotes, right, the attributes and I'll do some abbreviation, of being round. Isn't that one of the attributes of a drum? And how about hollow? Right? And maybe noisy? See how that works? How about for politician? What would you say for politician? Politician connotes the attributes of being what? Maybe saying having party affiliation, right? Being Democrat, Republican, Independent, Green, maybe interested in money. Some might say a liar. I'm not going to say that, but some might say. I've had students that put that on there before. How about the devil? Devil connotes the attribute of being what? Evil. How about crafty? Is that an attribute of the devil? Maybe living in hell? You see how this works? Take a look at this one at the bottom. Name three items denoted by the terms in the left-hand and right-hand column. Well, newspaper denotes the class members that might include the LA Times, right? We've got a local newspaper called the Daily Breeze. And there's also the News Pilot for San Pedro. Well, what is the tallest mountain on the earth? What is denoted by the tallest mountain on the earth? Isn't that Everest? Right? And on the right-hand column over here, the prime number is less than 10. That would probably be what? 2, 3, or 5, or 7. Now, is this a complete list? No, there's other newspapers we can list. Is this a complete list? Yes, this is. This is the only example of this, and these are the only examples of those numbers. Now, here's something where you really need to focus in, because this is not only on the quiz for chapter 2, it's on the midterm and on the final. It's putting these words in a particular type of sequence. They want it in the sequence of increasing intention. Picture in your mind a funnel. It starts very wide and it narrows down. As the sequence of terms advance, you're supposed to start with the one that is the least specific and go to the greatest degree of specificity. So which would be the first one in the sequence? Car, right? No. Vehicle. Because there's all types of vehicles. Then we're getting more specific by moving to a car, which would be 2. Now, type of car would be a sports car. That would be number 3. Number 4, which one do you think it is? That's right, Italian car. And then a specific type of Italian car would be a Maserati. How many of you girls own a Maserati? Yes, all of us guys would be very envious. Take a look at this and maybe you remember your geometry class. You got parallelogram, polygon, square, rectangle, and quadrilateral. You need to start which is the most general and work towards which is the most specific. That's increasing in intention. If you're struggling to recall what that was about, that's on page 91 of our text. Page 91 for review. Well, the most general would be a polygon, any number of sides, a many-sided figure, right? The second in the sequence would be a quadrilateral, which would be 4 sides, any type of sides, but has 4 of any dimensions. Next would be with more specific dimensions for a 4-sided, which would be in the shape of a parallelogram. So that would be the third in the sequence. Now, between square and rectangle, which do you think would be the 4th? Yes, rectangle, and then square would be very specific, where all 4 sides have to be exactly equal. See how that works? Let's do just a few problems in section 2.3, since we're working with definitional techniques, and take a look at recession here, the definiendum. And the words we're using to define that, the definiens reads, means for purposes of the National Bureau of Economic Research, I see that as offset by 2 commas, which gives me a context, 2 consecutive quarters of negative growth in real GNP or in aggregate output for the entire economy. Don't you think that is a precising definition? and you would be correct. A precising definition. Try your hand on this next one. Gravity means a force that results from the universal attraction that every particle of matter has for every other particle, and which varies directly with the mass of the particles and the invertly with the square of the distance between them. What type of a definition do you think that might be? Sounds pretty technical? Yeah, maybe even theoretical, right? Theoretical definition, and you would get the point. Try your hand at this. Television is the definiendum, the word that was going to be defined, means an electronic medium that keeps an entire nation of viewers in a state of semi-sarcosis by feeding them a steady stream of inane drivel. Do you think it's trying to paint a favorable view towards television or an unfavorable? Well, I would say that's probably a persuasive definition. And you would get the point if you chose that. And we'll do some problems with 2.4 after we finish going through 2.5. So let's go on ahead and jump back into our lecture. Well, we want to talk about some rules. Whenever you are doing defining, when you're defining a word in a paper that you're writing, when you are speaking and you are maybe defining a very complex concept to the argument, maybe your teacher's got you standing in front of the room. You have to read a paper and present something that you've written or researched or talk about a concept. It's very proper to first define your terms at the head of the paragraph that you're writing, the introductory paragraph or the introductory section of that paper you're writing, or as you're addressing your audience, to first define your terms. Well, there are some very specific rules for defining. These will serve you well, young scholars, as you go on to university and are having to write those papers or as you're doing presentations. You want to make sure that as you're defining your terms that you follow these rules. Do not break any of these rules. So now you can see the import, the weight associated with these rules for defining terms. So in this section, we're going to do a very brief survey of the 8 rules for constructing lexical type definitions. And this is very, very important. A lexical definition usually defines the way that a word is used. And so rule number 1 says that a lexical definition should conform to the standards of proper grammar. So as you're doing your defining, make sure that you are speaking properly. You're not breaking into the rules of grammar. Here's an example. If we were to define the word insanity in this fashion, we would be breaking rule number 1. Insanity means if you have an unsound or a deranged mind. Listen to that. Insanity means if you have an unsound or a deranged mind. This breaks rule number 1. We've broken a couple of the rules of grammar. The correction would be insanity means having the condition or having an unsound or a deranged mind. You need to state that there's a condition involved in there. It's not if you have, but it's a condition of having an unsound or a deranged mind. Some of these go very quickly, folks. Lexical definitions, rule number 2. Lexical definition should convey the essential meaning of the word being defined. It should convey the essential meaning of the word being defined. Give you an example. If we were to say snow means white stuff, we've not done a good job. We've not conveyed the essential meaning of the word snow. There's no mention of water. So we have broken rule number 2. The correction might be something like snow means small white crystals of frozen water formed from water vapor in the air. Very precise. We've not broken rule number 1 or rule number 2. We've conveyed the essential meaning of the term so our audience or our readers know exactly what we're talking about. Lexical definition, rule number 3. Let me roll that out to you. A lexical definition should be neither too broad nor should it be too narrow. You don't want it to be too broad or too narrow. Give you an example here. Clarinet, the musical instrument called a clarinet, means a wind instrument. The definition is too broad because the definiens, wind instrument, includes horns and trumpets and saxophones. And it includes too much. It's way too broad. The correction might be clarinet means a single reed woodwind instrument. And that way, you're neither too narrow or too broad, and you have not broken rule number three. I think you're beginning to see that critical reasoning requires specificity. You want to make sure that you're conveying proper meanings to your people that listen to you or read what you have to say. And there are rules associated with these critical reasoning techniques. Let's see. This is another example of number three, too broad or too narrow. That's what it is. And here's the example. Drill. The word drill means a tool for making holes. This definition is too narrow because drills are also used to make holes in metal or in plastic or in concrete. The definitions includes too little. The correction might be drill means a tool for making holes in hard material or in hard substances. And that would help us to avoid breaking rule number three. Another example might be apple means a red fruit. Apple means a red fruit. What's wrong with that? The definitions is too broad. The definitions could include plums. It's also too narrow because the definitions excludes green and yellow apples. So definitions that are too broad or too narrow fail to convey the essential meaning of the definiendum, the word that you're trying to define. You want to be on guard that you're neither too broad or too narrow. A defective definition, as you're probably noticing, can also break more than one rule. Well, let's push on to rule number four. A lexical definition should avoid circularity. Have to avoid circularity. For example, road rage, that's the word we're defining, the definiendum, means rage on the road. You see that what we're trying to define is also in the word that we're using to do the defining. In other words, the definiendum contains the definiens, or the definiens contains the definiendum. This definition is circular because it includes both. Correction. Road rage means violence directed toward another motorist or passenger. Then you don't break the rule, right? Let's give you some sample problems and see how you do. Take a look at this example having to do with the word wine. We're defining the word wine. Wine means a beverage made from grapes. In which way is this definition defective? Do you think it's bad grammar? Maybe it's circular. Or does it fail to convey the essential meaning? And if you said the third choice, you would get the point. It does fail to convey the essential meaning. There's nothing mentioned about it being alcoholic, and nothing about the variety that it might come in. And the definiens also could include soft drinks or grape juice that's also made from grapes. Take a look at this next one that has the word artist's easel, or the term artist's easel. That means an easel used by an artist. How many of you would go with bad grammar? Anybody choosing circular? Anybody for too broad? Well, those of you that chose circular, the second option, you would get the point. This includes the word in the definiendum. The definiens is included in the definiendum. Too circular. Next one, carnivore, the word that we're going to be defining. The word carnivore means a tiger. In which way is this defective? Is it too narrow? Or do you think maybe it's circular? How many of you might say it's too broad? Well, it is too narrow because it's only talking about a tiger. It's left out my sister-in-law, right? Just kidding. Thought to inject a little bit of humor this afternoon. I apologize for that. Yeah, it is too narrow, and you would get the point. Well, let's push on. We've left off with rule number four. We're now at rule number five of the eight, and we want to push forward. Rule number five. Rule five says a lexical definition should not be negative when it can be positive. A lexical definition should not be negative when it can be positive. For example, the word male means not being female. And it looks like we might have no difficulty in getting right back to rule number 5. Male means not being female. Well, rule 5 says you shouldn't be defining words or terms in a negative way when it can be said positively. And when we say male means not being female, it's defining male at the expense of a female. The correction should be something like male has, or male means the sex that performs the fertilizing function in generation. And that way you're not breaking rule number 5. Rule number 5 is not being broken. Avoid negativity in your definitions when you can be positive. Pushing on to rule number 6. And yes, some of these do go very quickly. Rule number 6. A lexical definition should avoid figurative, should avoid obscure or vague or ambiguous language. Rule number 6 says to avoid those types of language. Here's an example of breaking rule 6. If we were to define music as meaning the language of the soul, well, that might appeal to some of you soft jazz music listeners, especially here in Los Angeles that listen to The Wave 94.7. They would probably define music that way. Music means the language of the soul. But that is imprecise. It's too figurative. It's kind of obscure. We would correct that definition and say something perhaps like music means pleasing vocal or instrumental tones that have structure and continuity. It's a much better definition, less figurative, less obscure, less ambiguous. What I mean by figurative is expressing one thing that are normally intended to denote things or other things which might be regarded as similar. Like camel means a ship of the desert. Maybe in some Arabian countries, there's an etymological link between camel and a ship of the desert. But in our language, that is a figurative definition. We want to avoid that. Obscure means hiding the meaning of a word as a result of defective or inappropriate language. Vague means expressing a definition with terms that are blurred in meaning and lacking precision or have a continuous range of interpretation. And ambiguous, a term that goes all the way back to previous sections that we've talked about, means expressing a definition with terms that allow for more than one clearly distinct meaning. Well, we've done 1 through 6. Let's push on to 7 and 8, those rules. Let's see if you can follow along with this. Rule number 7, a lexical definition should avoid affective terminology. Affective terminology, one that is geared to hook our emotions. Take a look at this example. Feminism means a misguided movement that seeks to replace every important man with a woman. Well, this is almost fighting words, right? It is defining feminism against men, and that's unnecessary. We do not need to define terms in that kind of effective terminology. The correction might be more accurate to say feminism seeks to secure for women a status that is equal to that of men. So we want to avoid affective language, words that play upon our emotions. Finally, we're at rule 8, right? Rule 8 says a lexical definition should indicate the context to which the definiens pertains. For example, the word foul that we're going to define means 1, to hit a ball outside the field of play, or 2, to infringe the rules. Well, it didn't give us a context for either of those. The correction would be 1, in baseball, to hit a ball outside the field of play, or in basketball, to infringe the rules. Those are much better definitions. We're giving the context. We're stating a context in which we are defining these words. In just a moment, we're going to go to another video that talks about the strange origins of words. But I want to remind the young scholars out there to call in or to email in with an answer to our question, which is the question of the day. Give us an example of an unusual word, a made-up word, or a family word, and then give us the definition of that. Looks like we've got Blanca either calling in or emailing in. Thank you, Blanca. We appreciate that. An unusual word we use in our home is kachai or kachai. And if I had you on the phone, I would have you pronounce it for us. And if you call in, then we would be able to pronounce it correctly. And I'd encourage you to do that. But it means, do you understand? It kind of takes place of saying, you know. And that's a very interesting word. And I'm glad that you mentioned that. There are a lot of languages that have these kinds of words that make sure that the person following along is in fact following along. And they're randomly inserted so that the speaker uses them to make sure that people are tracking. And they look for some kind of affirmation that they're tracking along. And they insert these kinds of words. And I'd love to know what culture that comes from or what ethnicity that comes from, as I'm intrigued with languages. Thank you so much for that, Blanca. And I'd love to hear exactly how that is pronounced, as I don't see any diacritical marks on it, accents or anything like that. So I'm probably anglicizing it. Blanca, thank you for that. Well, we want to go to a video, one that gives some additional interesting facts. Beyond the criteria and the rules for lexical definitions, this gives us some facts about some very weird word origins. Watch this video.
Guys, the word tweet has entered the hallowed text of the Oxford Dictionary, which raises the question, is this the fall of Western civilization? In case you were wondering, no, this is not the fall of Western civilization. This is just the English language being the English language. Language isn't something we think about, especially when it's doing its job. For example, you don't really parse my words as strings of nouns, adjectives, and verbs. Language is for communicating. And because it's so good at what it does, it's alive. Nouns have a tendency to give birth to verbs over time, and individual words can have their own origin stories. Since this is the internet, let's start with something cute. Lemurs! The word lemur actually comes from the Latin lemuris, side note, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, which refer to the specters of the restless dead. Cute and spooky. And speaking of spooky, we've been going boo since the early 19th century. It's probably Scottish in origin, but if you say boo to a Turkish or Spanish speaker, they will also recognize it as an attempt to scare them. It should also be noted that booing at sporting events didn't originate until later. And as much as Europeans might boo Americans for calling their beloved football soccer, the term soccer actually originated in England. The term football had been kicking about for a good long time at that point. In fact, a game called football was banned by a Scottish statute back in the 1400s. During the 1800s, a version of the game called association football emerged, which became a sock or a soccer in usage before becoming soccer in the 1860s. As the popularity of soccer spread, it eventually became known as football again throughout England. American football, incidentally, is known as stop-start rugby with padding. Rugby, of course, is played without pads or helmets, which just, ow, brain injuries are not my favorite. And speaking of brains, human anatomy buffs will recognize the hippocampus as the part of the brain that affects things such as memory, while mythology geeks will immediately think of the hippocampus as Neptune's fishy, dolphin-y seahorse thing. Yeah, it turns out the brain thing came from the horse fish thing. Apparently in 1706, they thought that part of your cerebral cortex looked a bit like a fish. And because English is alive, here's a footnote on words like tweet, which have gained a new meaning from colloquial use. These meanings don't always stick once they lose their cultural context. For example, rutabagas are root vegetables, but apparently they were also slang for dollars in the 1940s, and in the 1920s, a fish could also be a college freshman or a first-time prison inmate. Same thing, right?
Fantastic. Well, we are going to do a few sample problems in just a few moments, but thankfully, Blanca has called in, and she can help us understand how to pronounce that word. So, Blanca, are you there? Are you with us? Blanca, are you calling from Stockton? Are you there? Hello.
Yeah, I'm here.
Hi, how are you today?
Good, how are you?
Good, and thank you so much for calling in. And let me tell you, Blanca, if I had the ability to award you an additional participation point, I would do that. Originally, we gave 2 points to people who called in, 1 point to people that texted in. But the dean said, you can't discriminate. You can only give 1 point. But I am going to thank you profusely for calling in so that you are demonstrating for all the rest of the young scholars how simple it is to call in and how nice I am to my callers. How are you doing so far?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing really good. And thanks again for calling in. I really appreciate that.
Yeah.
So tell us, how do you pronounce the word?
Well, you pronounced it right the first time. You say kachai.
Okay.
And kachai. My mom, she grew up in Chile, and they kind of used it as like someone just made it up, and they kind of use it as like a slang term.
Uh-huh.
And we just like at the end of the sentence, we're like, kachai, like, you know. Do you understand me?
I love that. Now, are you talking about Chile, the long, narrow strip of land that's the backbone of South America?
Yeah.
Is she from Santiago, Valparaiso, Viña del Mar, where? Or do you know?
She's from Santiago, I think.
Santiago. Yeah. That is a beautiful area. And if she was watching and she saw my last name, she would probably recognize that it, too, is Chileno.
Really?
I'm Chileno. My father's from Chile. My mother is from Kentucky. So that's why you have
the
light
Where's
features are from,
from
Kentucky, but the last name is from Chile. So have you been
so
down
cool.
there yet, Blanca? Have you visited Chile
what?
Ever?
Did what?
How did you like it?
What? My mom wants to know what part of Chile.
My father was born in Valparaiso and grew up in Viña del Mar.
Oh, that's so awesome.
Yeah. Well, Blanca, again, let me thank you for calling in. I so appreciate it. And if you have a chance to call in the future to respond to any of these things, we'd love to hear your voice again. And have a great day, okay?
Thank you. You too.
All right. Thank you. Bye-bye. Okay, folks, we said we would do a few sample problems. And you see how easy it is to call in. And you notice I don't bite verbally or physically. So encourage you to call in or to text in. Looks like... Elish has also given us another example here of a made-up word or a family-used word, and the word is NEPA, and NEPA, capital N-E-P-A. It stands for Northeastern Pennsylvania, which is where I grew up. There's not a cool story behind it. We're just lazy people. Oh, Elish, I love that. Thank you so much. You're also getting the extra point. And folks, it's just getting better and better. So give us more examples. I think this is one of the better questions of the day that we had. And so we'll have to try and get others of this caliber in the future that will get you responding. And it looks like we've got even another one. Genesia has called in or texted in. Thank you for that. And let me see if I'm pronouncing this right. Gentacular, I guess is the way it is, Gentacular, and that's the definiendum. The definiens that Genesia is providing for us is of or pertaining to a breakfast taken early in the morning or immediately on getting up. And you found this on the internet. And I agree with you. I think that is very interesting. Thank you for sharing that. That's probably a new word since it's on the internet, so it's giving us a stipulative definition, right? Good. Okay, well, let's do a couple of sample problems. That'll also give a chance for others to call in or email in. Let's do a few of these, and then we'll go back to the folks that are giving us some more examples of their participation for their participation points. The next one is the word poverty. That's the definiendum. Poverty means not having enough money. In which way is this definition defective? Is it needlessly negative? Would you think maybe it's vague? Maybe it's ambiguous. Well, if you said that it's vague, that's exactly right. How much is not enough? So we would consider that to be a vague definition. Take a look at the next one. Happy is the word we're going to define. The definiendum says not being sad. In what way is this defective? Is it effective? Is it obscure? How about needlessly negative? And if you chose a third one, you would be spot on the mark and you get the point on the quiz. That's absolutely right. Happiness, no need to define it in terms of being negative. It's needlessly negative. Very, very good. Couple of others. If we were to say the word candle and give it the following definition, and imagine, guys, if you were to go into a Hallmark candle store wanting to buy a scented candle for your date or your girlfriend, and you said, where are the candles? You know, those, or where are those pieces of petroleum distillate on axial fiber? Instead of saying candle, in what way would your definition be defective? Would you be vague with the clerk, or would you be obscure? Or do you think you'd be effective? And you're right, if you selected obscure, that is hidden. The meaning is actually hidden because the definiens is needlessly complicated. The last one before we go to our break, the word stroke means a single motion of a brush or a scoring unit or third something else. In which way is this defective? Well, it's not giving us a context, right? It's neither vague nor obscure. It's just not telling us what the context of the definition is. You know, the first one probably relates to painting. The second one to gold. Maybe another one is a stroke as if you were swimming. So, folks, these are great examples and also examples of questions that are very similar to what you'd find in the quiz and what you'll find on the midterm. Before we go to break, I've got one more. I want to catch Mike Mitchum. Mike, thanks so much. You're really diligent in texting in a lot of information for us. Really appreciate that. A number of you are really becoming familiar to us. And one day we want to hear you on the phone, actually. So let's see. Mike says, our family's word that isn't really a word is kine. And that's spelled K-I-N-E, and hopefully I'm pronouncing that correctly. It began when my grandpa asked my brother what kind of ice cream he wanted. So instead of saying kind, you say what kind. So there's always multiple options. Good. And it says one time when my grandpa, I want kind too. So now whenever any of us want ice cream, we ask for kind. I got it. Okay. Instead of what kind, now that's associated with ice cream. Very interesting. It's interesting how words not only take on different meanings, but how they evolve into something entirely different and mean something entirely different altogether. That's great. Well, folks, we are at 3:51. We're going to go ahead and take our break, and we'll see you in about 5 minutes. See you soon.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
You ought to be congratulated on undertaking a sometimes difficult but always rewarding task of earning your college education. You are here and you are in for a great ride. Want to be successful.
Learn more and you will succeed and excel.
Go Toros!
You can be the class of 2018 that changed the world.
You can do that because you're at CSU Dominguez Hills.
At Dominguez Hills, we want you to get better.
Are in control of your destiny.
Do well, go Toros.
I'm Timothy Hudson, member of the Drug and Alcohol Counselor Program faculty at California State University, Dominguez Hills. Abuse of tobacco, alcohol, and illicit drugs is costly to our nation, exacting over $600 billion annually in costs related to crime, lost work productivity, and health care. What's often not talked about is the emotional and mental costs that people abusing substances do to themselves and those around them. I'd like to invite you to join us for a series of live interactive discussions about addiction in America, what it looks like, how it can be successfully treated, and how you can pursue a career in counseling. Join us each week for information, encouragement, and solutions that can change the future for you and those around you. We look forward to seeing you.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
Hello, my name is Maria Rosales. I'm a senior at California State University Dominguez Hills. I'm majoring in Criminal Justice Administration. The reason why I decided to come to this campus was for its great faculty, great location, and friendly environment.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
And we're back. I hope everybody's doing well. Great afternoon for everyone. We have just finished section 2.5. Before we get into section 2.4, we said we'd swing back on it. We always want to do a few sample problems since there's homework associated with it. The homework for section 2.5 is Roman numeral 1 there at the end of section 2.5. That's problems 2 through 16 even. Let me go beyond the 16th problem and give you some examples of what you will be headed toward. And remember that the answers for all of these homework problems are on Blackboard in case you get stuck and if you want to double check your responses. So to try your hand at just a few of the assigned problems there at the end of section 2.5, let's go to the overhead camera. And we're supposed to criticize these definitions that were given in light of the 8 rules for lexical definitions. And so the first one we'll look at is problem number 26. It reads, tobacco is a plant grown in the southeastern United States that, when enjoyed in the form of cigars and cigarettes, produces a most delightful and satisfying taste and aroma. How many of you saw this word jump out? Enjoyed produces a most delightful and satisfying taste and aroma. Isn't that effective terminology? It is effective terminology. And it's breaking that rule that says you're not supposed to use effective terminology. So it's also trying to engender a very favorable view towards tobacco, right? When it's Also, the problem with it is it says nothing about that it is the only way as a very effective delivery system for nicotine into the human body. It also fails to say that it is one of the top, in the top 10 reasons or causes for death in the United States, one in five of the top 10 deaths associated with the smoking of cigarettes. Well, the definition doesn't say anything about that either, so it's failing on several counts. Take a look at number 27 with me. History is the unfolding of miscalculations. Well, I would say that that's probably figurative, and we're not supposed to define things in terms of figurative language. Maybe it's also ambiguous. The unfolding of miscalculations, if you were to say either figurative or ambiguous, I'd give you the point on either of those. The last one that we'll look at in the section is the word diet. Diet means like when you cut back on your calories. Well, this doesn't conform to the standard rules of grammar, does it? A diet is a regimen of eating and drinking sparingly so as to reduce one's weight. Like my doctor and my wife, the incessant nags that I need to stick to my diet. Okay, let's push on. We want to get into our next section here. And we're moving towards lecture section 2.4. Looks like we've got another video that we want to see first, though, that has to do with etymology. Etymology is the origin of words. And so many of our words in English come from other languages. And so this video has to do with the origin of English words. Let's take a look at this, and maybe we'll have a few comments when we get back. Take a look.
Hey,
catch up.
What's up? ABC.
Check me.
Shama.
All right.
Robot.
Hold.
Robota.
Me.
Barbecue.
What?
Barbacoa.
¿Qué pasó?
Shampoo.
Shampoo.
Etymological root of words, not only coming from other foreign languages that have seeped into by osmosis into our culture, but many of them come from way back in history. If we go to the overhead cam, there's a couple of words that are coming to my mind. One that has actually a very interesting story, the word dunamis. Dunamis, that's D, Y is the upsilon. Doesn't that look like dynamite? Dunamis, dynamite. Dunamis is the word for power. And dynamite is where the word comes from in the ancient Greek, the word dunamis. Take a look at this word, zer. This is a sigma. And this is the ancient X-E-R-O-S, Xeros, Xeros. Now, maybe you've heard a word similar to that. Have you ever heard of the word Xerox? Xerox? The Xerox Corporation was one of the first corporations that created the xerographic process, photocopiers. And the word Xeros means dry. Xerographic, graphe, Xerographe means dry, graphe means writing. So apparently, they must have had some Greek scholar that was familiar with ancient Greek that gave them the branding name for their corporation, Xerox. Isn't that interesting? So a lot of words come from our ancient cultures or even our current cultures, and they seep in and we embrace them and incorporate them into our own language. Well, pushing on into section 2.4. We finished 2.5, now we're going to circle back into 2.4. And these are various criteria for lexical definitions. We want to, a question of the day. That's the other thing we need to do before we get into 2.5. There is a video that we need to look at first. This is the video about the lexicon. And I think we're going to go to that next, the video about the lexicon. That is going to help us understand the question of the day. So if that is queued up and ready, let's do to that, and then that'll prepare us for the question of the day. Watch this video.
The word lexicon is a noun, and it's the vocabulary of a language or of an individual. My name is Mike Butcher. I'm the editor of TechCrunch Europe, which is a news blog about technology startups. Well, I think traditionally lexicon meant the way you talk to an individual or the vocabulary that you used. But in actual fact, of course, lexicon is about vocabulary. It's about the language that you use either to someone you're talking to or as part of a community. But I think that personally, the community aspect of lexicon, the word lexicon, is becoming much, much bigger. I think increasingly the way we use language is to talk in very different situations, especially online, and especially when we're talking in communities. The way that the communities are forming on the internet and on mobile means that we use many, many different types of language every single moment of the day. What's the style of language that we use to connect to people with TechCrunch? Well, it's very simple, really. We try and talk the kind of language that the technology community talks. We're brief, we tell jokes, we have little sort of asides, and I think that the way that the blog writers like us talk to our communities is very much as part of the community.
Okay, so there is a particular type of language that this specialist is talking about when we're in a particular area, when we're in a chat room, or when we're in cyberspace, or when we're in on the internet. So the question has to do with, does the way you use your language, does it vary? Think about your own use of your language. Does it vary with depending on who you're speaking with? So the question is, what are the reasons that you should or should not use the language of your community, like friends, and use that around your family or around your employer? Call in with your responses. Should you have one consistent language that you use with everybody? Or is it okay to have different types of language that you use with different types of people? So there's the 800 number, and you've got the email address. Call in with your responses so that you can get the point. We want to know reasons why you agree or why you disagree with that. And then we're going to push into our definitional techniques, continuing that in chapter 2.4. This has got seven definitional type techniques that depend on the ideas of intention and extension that we learned earlier in chapter 2. And you might remember from the graphic that there are a couple of different ways of looking at terms. And we've got a graphic that we want to put up that relates with the intentional or the attributes of a word versus the extensional meaning of a word, which has to do with class members. And the graphic that we has to do with the word student. And either that can come up behind me or on the or full screen, doesn't matter. But this is the graphic that we'd used before that talks about definitional type techniques. There we are. So we are going to be talking about defining things from its attributes, based upon its attributes, or defining a word and using a word based upon its class membership. So an extensional definition is one that assigns a meaning to a term by indicating the members of the class that the definition denotes. And let's talk about those for a minute. Extensional or denotative type definitions. Let's move on and give you some examples of that. The first is that you would either point to them, which is a demonstrative type definition, or you would name them individually. Which would be an enumerative definition, or the third is to name them as a group, the definition by subclass. So let's start with the first one, a demonstrative definition. This is probably the oldest method If you didn't know the word for something or you didn't know how to define something, you'd simply point at it. And I imagine in my mind's eye that this is probably how the cavemen spoke when they were hunting deer or something. And they see a deer in the distance, we're going to go in that direction. They would probably say, right? And they'd be pointing in the direction that the deer is at. They gave a demonstrative definition for, let's go over there, that's where we're going to find the deer. Well, probably more currently to give a demonstrative definition, if we're standing on Torrance Beach, which is just a few miles from here, maybe 15, 20 minutes, and one of you said, what is the Palos Verdes Peninsula? I've heard of it, but what is it? And I said, Palos Verdes means that, and I pointed to it over here or wherever it is. There you go. That would be an example of a demonstrative definition. And this is a complete demonstrative definition because only one of it exists. It's the only member of its class that's denoted by the definiendum. I could say, for example, that a book means multiple pages with a hard front and a hard back, a spine that has the title. The first few front matter have to do with publication, the authors, the back usually has an indexer, the table of contents. Yeah, I'm describing a book. The beauty of a demonstrative definition is you just say, this is it. Here's an example. This is what a book is. You simply point to it. That's a demonstrative definition. But all of these are typically partial demonstrative definitions. It indicates only some of the members of the class is denoted by the definiendum, the word that we're trying to define. So let's move on to another type of definitional technique beyond the demonstrative. Demonstratives are very popular, not only with cavemen, but with young kids that don't quite have the vocabulary yet. I remember one of my younger sisters standing in the kitchen and pointing up to the cupboards, going much like a caveman sound. She wanted her cereal. She knew where it was at. Maybe you have a younger sibling that is still doing that. Well, let's talk about actors and actresses and give an example of an enumerative definition. Actors and actresses mean people like, and then we would name them or we would show them. Is this a partial list of actresses or is it a complete enumerative definition of actresses? Well, it's only partial, right? Because we've left out RuPaul. And you've got to include RuPaul if you're talking about actresses, right? So it's partial because it doesn't include other actresses like RuPaul. To be a complete enumerative definition, we would need to list or show every single actress in existence. Can you give an example of an enumerative definition of what is meant by Pacific Coast State? And in your mind, if you're thinking Oregon, Washington, California, you'd be right. And that is a complete enumerative definition of what is meant by Pacific Coast State. Let's talk about a definition by subclass. Number three, definition by subclass. This kind of definition indicates the members of the class by naming subclasses. For example, a tool means a wrench, and there's different kinds of wrenches. Screwdriver, there's different kinds of screwdrivers, and a drill, and so on. Now, is this a partial or is this a complete definition by subclass? It's partial because we didn't list every tool and subclass of tools. Give you another example. Atomic component, that's the definiendum, the word that we're trying to define, means an electron, a proton, or a neutron. This is an example of a complete definition by subclass. Unless leptons do exist and we've left them out, then it would be complete, and maybe some other subatomic particles that you young scholars taking physics are aware of. Let's go to a few sample problems, shall we? Take a look at this one. The word city means Los Angeles, Paris, London, New York, and so on. What kind of an extensional definition is this? Is it a demonstrative definition, enumerative definition, or definition by subclass? If you said enumerative because you're listing out, you're enumerating examples of what the word city means, you would get the point. Only a few cities are mentioned. Take a look at this next one. The word moon. The moon means that as you point to it, right? Is that a demonstrative definition, enumerative, or a definition by subclass? Well, pointing to it means you're demonstrating, right? Demonstrative. If you check that box off, the first choice, you would get the point for that. Absolutely right. Lastly, the word conifer. Conifer means a fir, pine, cedar, and so on. What kind of extensional definition is this? We're talking about class of things, extension. Excuse me. Demonstrative, enumerative, definition by subclass. If you said the third one, definition by subclass, because there are subclasses of firs, pines, and cedars, then you would have gotten it right. And it's also a partial definition because only a few of the subclasses are mentioned by name. Well, we've done the extensional by denotation, talking about class member. Let's go in and talk about connotative or intentional definitions. This is assigning a meaning to a word by indicating the qualities or the attributes that the word connotes, a connotative definition. Remember, extensional definition assigns a meaning to a term by indicating the members of the class that the definium, the word being defined, that it denotes. Well, let's give our first example. Number four, a synonymous definition. The definiens is a single word that connotes the same attribute as the definiendum. This is a synonymous definition. Example, tranquility means peacefulness. The definiendum, tranquility, means peacefulness. Definiens, single word, that's a synonymous definition. See, these can be very handy if you're talking about a concept or you're writing about a concept and you want to be very specific or you want to give some examples. You can use a synonymous type of definition to get your point across or to be more precise in what you're talking about. Etymological definition is the fifth definitional technique. Etymological definition. This assigns a meaning to a word by disclosing the word's origin, either in its own language or in other languages, to give an etymological definition. Like oikos means house. Nemos means to arrange house. Oikos and nomos, put them together. Oikonomos, from economy, to arrange one's house. A steward or a home economist. See how all this kind of comes together with languages? Looks like Noah Lay has sent something into us. Noah, thank you so much. There are times when you should not use the language of your community with other people, because if you use technical terms concerning a specific subject, they might not know what you mean. Exactly right. Exactly right. Very good. And here's an example Noah's giving to us. I would not use photography terms such as ISO, depth of field, etc., when talking to people who are not very knowledgeable in that area, unless I explained beforehand what they meant. Very good. And yeah, there's a number of things that we know that relate to particular areas of knowledge that other people may not have the faintest idea. And we don't want to make them uncomfortable by talking about things that they may not understand unless we define our terms as we're going along, right? Noah, thank you for that. Very, very good example. Others, if there are reasons why you should or should not use language from a particular expertise or discipline, then give us some examples of that. We're at number six for an operational definition. Operational definition. And this assigns a meaning to a word by specifying the procedure that determines whether or not the word applies. It defines a word in terms of an operation, and that determines or not whether the word applies or not. For example, a substance is radioactive if and only if a Geiger counter registers a reading when the sensor is brought near the substance. And I want you to key on a word in the, or a phrase in the definiens, the words that are doing the defining of the definiendum, the word that we're trying to define. And that is the phrase, if and only if. That is key for the operational definition technique, if and only if. If that is in the definiens, then we're probably certain that we're talking about an operational type definition. The next definition, the last of the seven, is the definition by genus and difference. This was invented by Aristotle and is probably the most powerful form of definitional techniques. This definitional technique is more applicable and achieves more adequate results than any other kind of definitional technique. Matter of fact, if we were to look at page 108 or here on the overhead, there is a listing of the different types of techniques on the left-hand side of the page, and then the types of definitions that are produced across the top. Take a close look at that. Now notice that different types of techniques produce different types of definitions. There's only one, Aristotle's genus and difference, here at the bottom, that produces each of these, or can produce each of these types of definitions, far and above more powerful than any of these others. Therefore, it's probably worth our knowing how it works. This is table 2.1. Encourage you to take a look at that and jot the word K-N-O-W at the margin to make sure that you know how those work. Well, let's talk a little bit about the definition by genus and by species. Genus, excuse me, and difference. If I was to give you the example of the phrase doe means a female deer, the species term, says Aristotle, is the word doe. The genus term is the word deer. And we need a difference word that would be female. The difference is the attribute or attributes that distinguish the various species within a genus. In logic, the species is simply the smaller class of things that results when the genus, the larger class, is limited by the difference term. I'll give you an example using ice and water. The definition by genus and difference. Ice means, and ice here is the species, means frozen water. So you notice how the larger class here of water and ice is the smaller class, and the difference is when it is frozen. Just one example of how the difference is the attribute of being frozen. Very powerful technique. I've got a few other examples for you. What you do first is select a term that's more general than the term that's being defined. And this is the technique to use, this Aristotelian definitional technique. You select a term that's more general than the one that's being defined. Then you narrow it down so that it means the same thing as the term that's being defined. And then you ask, what is the specific difference? So here's a couple of examples. Fawn means a very young deer. A skyscraper means a very tall building. You see, notice the difference here. Notice these differences. Daughter means a female offspring. Husband means a married man. With these kinds of examples, folks, I think you see how it works. And this is techniques, one of the others, that can be very applicable to a section of your paper or your speech or presentation or in a debate where you're defining terms. Matter of fact, in a debate, you can really trip up your opponent if they are not very carefully defining their terms. You can really run them all over the landscape because you're aware of these definitional techniques. You can pick them up pretty quickly. But folks, we've got a few other sample problems that we'd like to go through just to make sure that these concepts are solidified in your mind. Let's go on ahead and take a look at this first one, which has to do with the word proceed. The word proceed, and it is derived from the Latin verb procedere, which means to go ahead. Is this a synonymous definition? Is it an etymological definition? Or would you say that it's a definition by genus and difference? If you were to say etymological definition, you would get the point because the Latin ancestry is given regarding the term in the definiendum. And take a look at the next one. Indolence means laziness. What kind of an intentional definition is this? Would you say synonymous definition, etymological definition, definition by genus and difference? If you said synonymous definition, the first choice, you would get the point. This definiens is laziness, single word that means the same thing as indolence. Bore means a male pig on our next definition, our next sample problem. Boar means a male pig. What kind? Synonymous? Etymological? Definition by genus and difference? That's correct. If you chose the third one, you would be absolutely right. It names the genus and the difference there. What about a joke is funny if and only if people laugh when it's told? What would you say about that? A joke is funny if and only if people laugh when it's told. What kind of intentional definition? How many would say operational? How many synonymous or definition by genus and difference? If you say operational, you'd be exactly right, especially if you remembered the key phrase for an operational definition of if and only if. The operation is telling the joke and determining whether the audience laughs or not. Exactly right. How about the next one? Vegetable means things like a tomato, turnip, potato, and so on. What kind of a definition is this? Definition by subclass, analogical, enumerative? If you said definition by subclass, you would be exactly right. Exactly right. These are subclasses of other vegetables. There's different types of tomatoes, different types of turnips, different types, subclasses of potatoes. We are naming or identifying the definition of vegetable by giving examples of its subclasses, right? And I think we've got just a couple more here. A potato is cooked if and only if it is soft when removed from the oven. Demonstrative, etymological, operational. And a number of you are getting this. Exactly right, operational, the last one. The operation consists of removing the potato from the oven and determining its softness. And the last one is philosophy. Philosophy is derived from the Greek word philos, meaning loving, and sophia, meaning wisdom. What kind of definition is this? How many of you would say demonstrative? How many etymological? How many operational? Well, if you did the second choice, etymological, you would be absolutely right and you would get the point. It gives the Greek ancestry for the definiendum. Folks, we've got some homework that you need to try your hand on to make sure that this is becoming solid in your minds. Take a look at the pages 108 to 111, Roman numeral 1, problems 2 through 10 even, and section Roman numeral 2 here at the end of 2.4, problems 2 through 8 even. And a couple of reminders to you here at the end of chapter 2. To reread the chapter, review the notes, take quiz number 2 on Blackboard. We'll have that up and running very soon. There'll be ample time for you to take it. We usually keep it up and running for about a week or so. And we will then be discussing your first critical reasoning response here in the next time that we meet. Make sure that you have your printouts, as we mentioned at the lead on the biomedical decision making and whom will you hire. For all of the folks here at DHTV, we'd like to bid you a good afternoon, and we will see you next Wednesday. Take care, everybody.